started with a reference to you in his book, and it reminded me of this very famous Greek saying, En arhin idan o logos, en arhin idan europaikemos. So, at the beginning there was, there is, there was you. And this is not a coincidence, because he will further in his book linked all the important narrative actors around and inside this conflict somehow to be EU itself, and what kind of perspective EU is creating. The book is built upon, for example, how in the first chapter Greece of Papandreou and Simitis, or Simitis of Papandreou, have gone through a change of Greek foreign policy vis-à-vis Turkey, which has a lot to do with the existence of the European Union and with the fact that Greece is a member of the European Union. That is actually one of the important changes which will lay down, if you want, somehow the fundamentals for a solution. Actually, he starts, I must sort of say that he's considering in this book all the actors like Greece, Turkey, EU, and United States. We could call them foreign actors, important actors in relation to Cyprus question, and then he looks into the two communities and he tries to explain how the momentum of a comprehensive settlement has been achieved between 2002 and 2004, and missed exactly by the referendum of 2004. So, in short, it is actually a book of rather political science, somehow with international relations elements, studying the political actors and their positions and such a question, which all of them had somehow to review their positions because the EU was there as a kind of unmoved mover. So, as I said, first change comes with Greece's overview of foreign policy vis-à-vis Turkey, and actually what Greece thinks if Turkey will somehow be accommodated into the European Union, that would most probably also change the attitude of Turkey vis-à-vis Turkish differences, but also to the Cyprus question. So, in fact, Cyprus question, which somehow disturbed the Greco-Turkish reconciliation achieved by Venizelos and Atatürk after 1923, we came to another situation in the 90s. There, Cyprus question could have been solved, and a new kind of Greco-Turkish rapprochement began. Here, Pericleos refers to a linkage doctrine of Kissinger, which if Cyprus obtains a EU perspective, and at the same time Turkey is on the track towards EU, a kind of momentum for a solution will emerge. And indeed, a turning point in this aspect is, of course, the Helsinki deferral of the EU, where Turkey actually is getting a kind of candidate country towards accession, and Cyprus secures accession to EU with or without a solution. At the same time, Chrysostomos PERICLEOUS studies in depth also the American foreign policy, and vis-à-vis Turkey especially, how American foreign policy of their post-cold era is somehow trying to accommodate Turkey into EU in a way so that Turkey may become a stable democracy, also important to American foreign policy in the region. So, Holbrooke's initiative, we have a kind of, in 1996-97, on the way towards Helsinki, this double strategy. On the one hand, Republic of Cyprus should continue towards the European Union accession, and Turkey will get on the track towards the EU. And that would bring a kind of momentum for a solution in Cyprus. Now, chapter 4, there is a study about Turkey, is another important actor, They are actually the writer starts from Ottoman period through Kemalist Turkey until the moment AKP of type Erdogan came to the power in 2002. And that study, of course, it's a good study. It gives us an overview what kind of processes Turkey has gone through and why Turkey, the Turkey of type Erdogan, in 2002 came to a point to review the traditional policy of Turkish government vis-à-vis Cyprus. Because for time Erdogan and its party, AKP, EU accession became such an important element of its surviving, so that this internal dilemma between Turkey and the tension between Kemalists and Islamists, in a way, opens the way to EU, and Tayyip Erdogan engaged himself and his party into the EU perspective of Turkey. That was a rather important political change to Turkey that, as Chrysostomos was notified, Greek Cypriots failed totally to understand. But as we see in the book, Greek Cypriots not only in this case they failed to understand the major changes, they also failed to understand the important political changes also to the same period within the Turkish Cypriot community. So, from strategic question derives from this book for me, which needs a further discussion, why the Greek Cypriot community fails to read correctly Turkey and the Turkish Cypriot community. It seems to be a kind of historical default. Now, Cyprus, chapter 5 of the book, actually, deals with the Greek Cypriot community altogether, which I want to keep rather to the end in my presentation, and continue to say some words on chapter 6, which is the Turkish Cypriots, another actor. One good thing about this book is that talking about the conjectural events of how the actors took his position vis-à-vis Annan Plan, at the same time, this writer takes the readers to a long historical journey each time about the old actors. In this case, too, about Turkish Cypriots, Chrysostomos will take us back to Ottoman period, how the idea of Greek demand of embassy's unification with Greece mobilized Turkish Cypriots against this idea, how Turkish Cypriot community get politicized and in a counter-nationalism develop its own embassies in a way, unification with motherland Turkey, as you know, with the concept of Taksim, partition of Cyprus. And he follows the Turkish Cypriot community after 74, and he identifies how actually the de facto partition failed to deliver any permanent perspective to the Turkish Cypriot community, and how this community came to upset the whole structures in the north, the political discourses of nationalism, and seek a unification of Ireland as a common patrie of all Greek and Turkish Cypriots, of course, by wishing to secure the EU accession also for herself. That my major change, especially during 2002 and 2004, was again actually ignored fully by the Greek Cypriot policymakers, ignored or misinterpreted or underestimated, anyway, somehow again a failure to put things correct or to understand the importance, historical importance of that reality of Turkish Cypriots. Now, in chapter 7, you will see all the UN proposals. Which starts from the beginning to the end of Annan Plan, which are based actually on a common logic that the only available solution after 1974 is a kind of power-sharing model based on a federal state and political equality of two communities. And we see in these proposals how less the UN attitude changed over the years. The main philosophy remained there. So this shows us actually also somehow for the future don't hold anything more different than this, because that turned into a historical, legal, diplomatic reality for the Cypriots if they want to arrive at a compromise. Now, chapter 8 deals how we came to the referendum in Cyprus and all the detailed descriptions how, on the one hand, the EU accession of the Republic of Cyprus was forcing all the sides to compromise, even to accept the Annan plan as it first was presented, but how then the Greek Cypriot policy changes when the Republic of Cyprus manages to secure officially the accession of the Republic into the EU in 2002 and 2003 April. Actually, the actual change in policy on the Greek Cypriot side doesn't come immediately after Ben Papadopoulos came to the power, but it came after the Republic of Cyprus became a member officially in 2003 April. Actually, until then, Papadopoulos, he himself, says that he continues the policy of Mr. Kyriakides and of course of Mr. Markis. Now, this policy will change when Mr. Markidis and Kyriakides manage to put Cyprus into the EU when deliberating in the hands of Mr. Papadopoulos. Now, at that moment, this famous interview, which the writer very cleverly knocked down, referred to the first very important interview of Mr. Papadopoulos given to Vima magazine in May 2003. I'm very glad you notified the citizens in Europe. There, Mr. Papadopoulos actually, in many simple Greek words, tells us something very clear. I am now a member of the EU, and I'm not interested in this plan anymore. So, from there onwards, all the details actually shows how the pre-decision taken to blow up the plan was systematically implemented at 2004 April. Now, it is quite important to see the role of the press, the journalists, manipulation, disinformation, miscommunication, distorted communication, all sorts of measures actually are taken in a conspirative way, the result actually was that expected to be allowed no. In this whole process, of course, the writer did not fail to refer to one historical major fault done by the Communist Party of Cyprus by Bakel. Actually, when all the world made this conspiracy to arrive at a solution, Bakel had the idea that the conspiracy was against the party and Papadopoulos which were aiming to come to the power. So, under these circumstances, in a way which I'm describing, as EU, as Turkey, Greece, United States, they fought a war, a diplomatic war, to create a political environment. If in which a possible of Cyprus question, the solution of Cyprus question would have been possible, and actually the Turkish intransigence would have been breaking down of the international regime. And in fact, we arrived successfully there after AK Party came to the power in 2002. But this is the moment that Mr. Papadopoulos, Mr. Pierikos, also to climb to power. And of course, by the support of Akel. So, by this, I am linking now the analysis, the big analysis the writer did in chapter 5 about the Greek Cypriot community and how we came to this failure in depth. So, his analysis is very interesting because, again, he makes a kind of long historical analysis by going back to the Ottoman period, and the rise of Greek nationalism in Cyprus. It's an official doctrine of the Greek state, or an idea how this was promoted to Cyprius, how the Greek Cypriot community turned into a kind of dynamic community of Greeks fighting for unification with Greece, and then how the old struggle for emergencies failed in a way by ignoring the political realities, as the author puts it, by the policymakers within the Cypriot community. Now, this I will add something from my analysis to that analysis by saying that actually the impossibility of the emergencies movement takes us back to 1922-23. It is important to see, in a historical moment there, the whole Megali idea has been defeated by the Greek state itself after the age of man or catastrophe, we have the rise of the micro-mechanic here in Cyprus. And that fragments the Greek Cypriot elites from the very beginning. Fragments them because only political language they know, formed by mechanity itself, is towards unification with Greece. But Greece is a poor, dependent motherland which cannot promote anymore enosis. And this fragmentation, actually, to my mind, is personified and internalized by the phenomenon of Makarios himself, which, on the one hand, who would hope for the energies, on the other hand, who would leave the reality of the Republic of Cyprus, being president of the Republic, on the one hand, which actually, of a state which outlawed energies, but on the other hand, being ethnar, Byzantine, Andage, in all the rituals of. So that made actually enosis impossible, but also something else also impossible, namely to have a realistic estimation of politics and go or to a kind of compromise with Turkish Cypriot community, and maybe also to find to have certain dialogue with Turkish Cypriot community. It is exactly why the Republic of Cyprus would also fail on this ground. Independence based on political equality of two communities in a way of interdependence, which it means if you don't consider Turkish Cypriot political will, you can't produce any political decision. That independence is exactly which will be refused by the Turkish Cypriot political elite by trying at the beginning again, maybe their luck for enosis between 64 to 68. And then came back to an idea of independence, but the independence of the Republic of Cyprus, which is actually now de facto a Greek Cypriot nation state, without any Turkish Cypriot community involved anywhere yet. So, in that sense, what Makarios does in 68, this very important change in his politics, where he says and states, enosis seems to be desirable, but not possible. What is possible is the independence. Even that independence actually is not so much effective, is not so much possible, because it doesn't consider the existence of Turkish Cypriots. And this is exactly why we are ending up in a kind of tragic moment in 1964. After 1974, in the Cypriot community, we have two realities. Two realities which are deriving both from the father of the nation, from Makarios. One is long-term patriotic struggle, and the other one is a realistic opening towards a compromise. So we have a fragmented Greek Cypriot community as we had in 1930s and 40s. Realist on the one hand, patriotic fighters on the other hand. But there was something very important, something wrong, and something very important, wrongly, something very important wrong in the camp of realists. Because in the camp of realists, you had Akel and Lafros Kyrillis together after 74, which would never cooperate. So fragmentation on the realists and rejectionists actually is not, doesn't tell us everything. What is more important, sometimes one of these realists finds himself in the rejectionist form. And that is sometimes Mr. Kyrillis critical, sometimes Akel of the Lafros. And that gives us actually what Chrysostomos says, our policy, the Greek Cypriot policy, is determined by populism, maximalism, and power concerns. And this is why the referendum of 2004 actually